Order, order, and welcome to today's session of the Transport Select Committee, which is our final day of evidence for our accessibility and transport inquiry. Before we start, just for our records, could you please state your name and organisation, please?
Of course, Chair. My name is John Kirkpatrick. I'm Deputy Chief Executive at the Equality and Human Rights Commission.
Thank you, and we're grateful for your time and evidence this morning. If I could start off by asking, the Equality Act contains a number of provisions in parts 3 and 12 which guarantee the rights of disabled people when travelling. Can you briefly set out your organisation's role in enforcing those rights and give us your general assessment as to how effective that role has been?
Of course, Chair. We are, as you indicate, the regulator of equality and or the regulator of equality and human rights law, and in particular the equality obligations imposed by the Equality Act. We consider ourselves to try to be a strategic regulator. That means that we regulate in a variety. We operate in a variety of ways in this respect. We try and enhance the level of the quality and availability of evidence to allow for regulation. We try and influence standard setting. We try and monitor compliance with those standards and assess it. And where necessary, we act as an enforcer in various ways. In this context, our frame of reference is probably a bit narrower than it is in some others, simply because of the interaction of the Equality Act and the various regulations that govern transport and accessibility of transport, and the fact of those regulations and the fact that the Equality Act, we don't have power to act under the Equality Act where those regulations apply. Therefore, for the most part, we consider both for that reason and for reasons of effectiveness that actually most of the law in this area is probably better applied and enforced by the regulators under those regulations. And we definitely see our role as working with them to encourage them to follow their, or to comply with their, the public sector equality duty, which binds them as it binds others, and to regulate effectively in that way. That's not to say we don't act. We have acted in the past. We have done that. We have a record that I think we are moderately proud of, and therefore I think we clearly see that we do have a role in this area, and we feel that particularly in times when we have, when transport has been a strategic priority for us, which it has been for periods in the past, certainly, we have had a real impact for the benefit of disabled travellers.
And in terms of the actions that you have brought, can you give us a general overview of the number of organisations you've taken to court that have been fined, and you know, perhaps one or two specific examples?
The numbers are relatively small, and our powers are somewhat constrained. We have powers to inquire, we have powers to investigate where we have reason to believe that there has been a breach of equality legislation. We tend, where we can, to work with people. We use, for example, our Section 23 powers to under the Equality Act to agree action plans, to agree with providers or whoever it might be, how they might go about improving the position. If I take you back, not necessarily to numbers, but to kind of specific examples, so a couple of examples of what we've done there. Earlier this year, we concluded a Section 23 agreement. That means it finished with London North Eastern Railway. That was initiated as a case related to a visually impaired customer who had probably, had been very poorly served on their by that company, but the fact that our preferred means of working with them was to make an agreement with them, what that did was enabled us to oblige them to think much harder and much more rigorously about the way they go about dealing with accessibility for passengers, and to improve their practice on that front. So that's one example. The other kind of prime example, I suppose, would be the action we took against Network Rail to ensure that they properly secured accessibility of stations while they were being refurbished. It was a matter of lifts primarily at both Piccadilly Station in Manchester and in Macclesfield. So those are two other kind of prime ones. I can talk some more about some of the other things we've done if you'd like me to.
Oh, well, my colleagues and I will dig into some of those points later. You mentioned that you work with other regulators, such as Civil Aviation Authority, ORR. Is that a sort of statutory engagement, or is it just a practice that's evolved over time?
It's a practice that's evolved. Those regulators are themselves, as I say, bound by the public sector equality duty as under equality law, and to a certain extent it is our job to keep an eye on whether they, and indeed all the other public bodies who are subject to that duty, are complying with it. The nature of our engagement is not because there's something in the law that says you must talk to these people with this frequency about these topics. It's rather because where we think there are issues that can be best pursued by either cooperation between us or a kind of proper allocation of responsibilities between us, then we think the right thing to do is to interact with them on that front. And as a result, therefore, we have somewhat different levels of interaction with different regulators and have had over time. Most recently, we've spent more time with the ORR than with some of the other regulators for reasons that will be obvious, I think.
Thank you. Final question from me for now. Do you think that sort of informal, loose engagement works, or do you think there needs to be a sort of more specified level of engagement?
It's varied in our experience, and our practice with different regulators is different. We have formal memoranda of understanding with some other regulators in other sectors, with the Care Quality Commission, for example, and we found that useful in kind of teasing out different responsibilities in terms of engagement between us. We don't, as it happens, have any formal memoranda of understanding with any of the regulators that this committee is concerned with. We have not felt the absence of that. But there certainly can be circumstances where actually having that formalised in one way or another is quite helpful. The absence of a memorandum of understanding, of course, does not let them off the hook in terms of the public sector equality duty. They are still obliged to do the things they are obliged to do.
Thank you. Carl, can
you turn to you? Thank you, Chairman. Mr. Kirkpatrick, thank you very much for being with us this morning. It all sounds very touchy-feely to me. So I don't think you really got appointed as regulator of the regulators. So you used language where you said the number of actual actions you've taken is very small. How small? Is it zero?
It's not zero. If I go back over a period of 5 years, say, in the period of our strategic plan that ran from 2019 to 2022, we opened up a transport legal support fund. We have powers, as I think you probably know, both to bring actions in our own right, a strategic litigation, but also to assist individuals or groups bringing actions where they need to do so. That legal support project was designed to do the latter of those. That supported 26 cases through its life, of which 6 had broadly positive outcomes. The other 20 achieved something in terms of clarification of the law or routes to.
In those 3 years, how many actions did you take off your own back?
Off our own back, we have taken, I think we took 2 strategic actions coming off that, or coming out of those cases, because we decided we were actually better off.
Next question, how many people are in your senior management team? Obviously you're the deputy chief executive, you have a chief executive. How many other people are in your senior management team?
I have another 7 colleagues.
Okay, did anybody take responsibility directly for transport as a strategic aim?
To be honest, that was before my time, so I wouldn't be able to tell you that. It's not a strategic aim now for us, so the answer at the moment is no, we don't have anybody who is specifically responsible.
Did the senior management team, however much they all earn between them, do they think that they did enough in those 3 years on the specific issue of transport or not?
I think we feel we did a respectable job within the capacity of our powers and our budget to make a difference to the accessibility of redress for people who were affected by that fund. And I think we feel that we've made a difference by virtue of our strategic litigation, because the fact that we've litigated against, for example, LNER does not just affect LNER, it causes all the other rail operators, and you've had them in these seats as well, I think, to think about, well, actually, what did they do there? If we don't have our house equally in order, then we'd like to think that that they would act in response to that. So I think that, I understand the point that One doesn't want to act entirely kind of consensually, that there are times when one actually needs to bring the...
I'm going to interrupt you and say, surely, it's, you know, from sitting from my perspective here, it's great that you all sit in meetings and drink coffee and tea and eat biscuits. We can all do that, and it's Olympic sport for some people in Quangos, etc. But actual, what proper actions have been taken that actually you can stand up and say, this is something where we've delivered on the role and responsibilities that we have and we've been given?
I think the answer to that is that not by sitting and drinking coffee, but rather by setting out with people, this is what we think you need to do. That's the way the Section 23 provisions work. We and they agree an action plan, and that action plan needs to be one that causes change in behaviour on the part of the person who's committing to do it, which should be the change in behaviour that improves circumstances. So I don't think it would be right to characterise that as soft. They are we have to negotiate that, and they have to agree it. If they don't agree, so if we can't agree an action plan that we think is adequate, then there are other options that we can pursue to greater degree.
And just finally, on process, I'm going to pick up something else you just said. You're here on your own, which fair play to you for being here on your own. No chief executive. Obviously, there's members of the senior management team been here, or been at your organisation since prior to 2019, or are you all new men?
No, we're not all newbies. There are others who were around earlier, and I could tell you more if you wanted to know the history about how we organised our responsibility for those things in the past. I don't know that off the top of my head because I am still the newbie.
It would have been helpful coming to a Transport Select Committee to have somebody who's had the experience of when it was a strategic aim to sort out the transport sector. Not knocking the fact that you're in front of us, but maybe you didn't want to take that message back for the next time you're having a meeting with or without tea and coffee and biscuits.
I'll happily pass that on.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Chairman.
Paul, you wanted to come in on the back of this.
Thanks, Chair. Again, thanks, Mr. Kirkpatrick, for being here. Just following on the same sort of theme in terms of, you know, where you've engaged and the like, the Equality and Human Rights Commission support scheme for transport accessibility has provided legal aid to 26 people. But we had one of our witnesses alone told us they'd brought 20 cases and had 20 other cases pending. We know that you can't do individual cases, but, you know, given some of the high profile things we've seen, should you not, you know, in the terms of being more active and being more engaged, be picking up your case situations and actually driving them rather than waiting for individuals who are with disabilities, etc., to pull them themselves? You know, should you not be overarching that?
Where we think it's worth doing, we can, and we have. To take the obvious example, the question is how we then act, because our ambition would be to try and act in the way that we think is most likely to have an impact, which might be to take an individual case. Our view has generally been that it's more likely to be to work with the collective of other regulators or whoever it might be. So, for example, the most recent large issue, and I'm sure you'll want to talk more about this possibly with the ministers rather than with me, relating to the closure of ticket offices, or the proposal to close ticket offices. Our view is that where those proposals came forward, we had some concerns about whether the equality implications of that had been properly thought, of those proposals had been properly thought through, and we considered the best way to do that was to engage with the department and the regulator and talk to them about it. And as I'm sure you know, we issued kind of public comment on that consultation, setting out what we thought some of those concerns might be. Our view was that as a regulator, we were better off doing that in an attempt to head off, or at least to make sure that such proposals are properly considered, than we would have been had we sort of let it happen and then tried to support a legal case thereafter. So it's an example of what is the most impactful course of action we think we could take, was the way we thought about it.
But isn't it a case that if the regulators aren't enforcing accessibility duties under their public sector equality duty, that you should be pushing the regulators and you should be really on top of them in terms of what's happening?
We can and we should, and we have had conversations, as I say, both with the department and recently with the ORR about the public sector equality duty. Our impression is, and you heard from them about it. When I read the evidence, I don't recall exactly what was said, but my impression is that the ORR take seriously their obligations under the public sector equality duty, and they of course both have their own obligations and the obligation to ensure that those they regulate comply with the full range of the law, including those. So our sense is that there is, you know, there is movement in that area, and that it's positive, and that the engagement of the regulators is positive. As I think I said earlier, I think it's also important to remember that most of the issues that arise that we are aware of anyway, it seems to us, are both properly dealt with by the regulators and probably better dealt with by the regulators, because they are more expert in the detail of the regulations and of the situation than we are. So our concern, exactly as you said, is to keep an eye on whether we think they are taking their obligations seriously and leave the principal burden of enforcing in specific cases or pursuing specific instances to them.
I think, just to follow on from what was said, I think our concern is whether you are too hands-off in that situation, and you are observing but not enacting, you're not enforcing and not going back to the regulators and pushing them hard enough.
Well, I can only say I think our view is we need to think about where we can have the most impact, where the issues that are most salient are arising. In the general transport space, our sense was that the most salient issues on which we needed to be keeping both the departments and the regulators' feet to the fire were the recent proposals around ticket offices, and our choice of a way to work there was to press both the department and the regulator on their action. I don't think that could be characterised as sitting back. I think that could be characterised as acting. I guess the point I'm trying to make is that our view is that the most effective way of acting is not necessarily to be bringing individual cases. We are neither empowered nor equipped to do that in a kind of serial way. Rather, we're trying to make the system work better for those passengers.
I'll leave it there, Chair.
Thank you. Jack?
Still on this point around your strategic priorities, do you think during that period that transport accessibility was one of your priority aims, that things actually improved?
I think we'd like to think so. Certainly in terms of the legal support scheme, we set ourselves some objectives for that specifically. I mean, one of the things that I know you've, one of the pieces of evidence, or one of the things you've, I know you've been told, is that it has in the past been very difficult for people to find advisors, and sometimes difficult to find lawyers to take cases. Clearly, the fact that there were then another 20 or 20 plus cases on the books indicated that there were more better sources of advice out there for people. I think even some of the cases that didn't necessarily yield an outcome have actually helped in clarifying the law where it is. You had Mr. Pawley sitting in this seat a few weeks ago. We supported his case, and the way in which that one was decided clearly clarified the law on what the obligations of bus operators were and weren't, and the way in which they should do that. And that seems to me to be a desirable impact.
You've mentioned some of the evidence that we've heard, and some of that was pretty scathing, really, in terms of the experience of some of those individuals with accessibility needs, in terms of their daily experiences of travelling around the country. So why is it that you think that this is no longer needing to be a strategic priority for your organisation?
I think my best answer to that would be, the fact that it's not a strategic priority does not mean we don't think it matters.
It's not one of your top issues. Why is it not? If you think it's so important and think it needs the attention that you've suggested, it no longer is one of your top priorities.
In the strategic plan that we are currently two-thirds of the way through, we work on a three-year strategic planning horizon. The strategic plan that we're currently two-thirds of the way through, we had to make some choices at the start of that, which was in the midst of the pandemic, about where we were going to focus our attention. And at that point, and in those circumstances, we focused more on the impact on the equalities impacts on children and young people and on health and social care that we could see around us at that point. So that's not to say we regard this as unimportant in any more than we regard the rest of our range of activity as unimportant. But where we are seeking to move the system, We will seek to concentrate and focus such resources as we have in some areas at a time. At the time of the pandemic, when transport appeared to us to be not a priority, but a lower priority than some of those other things, we moved a little way away from that. That also reflects, I think, the fact that we felt we had actually made a bit of a difference in the previous strategic plan period.
What evidence have you got of that?
Well, I think our sense from the nature of the queries and questions that we see, I mean, we're not a complaint receiving body, but we do get intelligence from others who do. We see a number of issues still out there for disabled passengers, absolutely. For the most part, they seem to be issues that are best addressed within the framework of the existing law and within the framework of the existing regulatory system by the regulators themselves, by duty holders. So there are a lot of things about accessibility of taxi and private hire services, for example. There are still some things about accessibility of buses. And you had evidence from those responsible for both of those things that they are trying to move those sectors over time.
I think it would be very useful if you can provide some hard evidence that things have improved, because from what we're hearing, it's actually the reverse. Since the pandemic. So I think if you could possibly write to the committee, if you have some evidence to suggest that this no longer needs to be a strategic priority for your organisation, that would be very helpful.
Happy to do two things. First, I can provide you with such evidence as we have on that. But the second thing would be to say we will be consulting in the course of the next 9 months or so on a new strategic plan going forward. And one of the things we will be looking at is what does that evidence tell us right now? And we will obviously need to revisit a variety of things in that context.
Thank you, Shane.
Thank you. Sarah.
Thank you, Chair. It sounds just from that conversation there that there's a lot of strategic plans going forward, but a lack of action for people, to be quite frank. Do you genuinely believe that you have the necessary expertise and resources to pursue breaches regarding transport accessibility law?
Well, I think I definitely think we have powers if we need them. As I say, we have powers to investigate, we have powers to support cases, we have powers to pursue cases on our own. Those powers are constrained, as I say, by the fact that the regulation, that we can't pursue things that are properly pursued under the regulations. The Equality Act is a kind of fallback from that. So, which is why I talked about us using our power to seek to press and influence the regulators rather than necessarily take action from ourselves. That also speaks to the question of expertise. We would not pretend to be as expert in the situation on the railways as the ORR, in the situation on the roads as the traffic commissioners, in the situation at airports and in the air as the CAA, and so on and so forth. So they have they unquestionably have better expertise than we do, which is one reason for doing that. And we are constrained on resources. We have roughly half the budget we had 8-10 years ago. We have to prioritise, as I was telling Mr. Brereton, reasonably rigorously. So our capacity for acting for pursuing expensive investigation and potentially litigation activity is constrained. That's why we have to make choices.
Now, are there any other factors that lead to those constraints? So you've mentioned the costs, but is it maybe potentially a shortage of legal experts regarding accessibility law?
Not that we're aware of. As I say, one of the, I think, desirable outcomes from the Transport Legal Support Project was that it did, I think, somewhat increase the numbers and availability of legal advisers willing and able to act in this area. And we had some evidence after that closed that there were more people talking to us about their availability and willingness to act in that area. Now, clearly, many of them will only act if instructed and paid, and therefore there's a cost implication to that, which brings us back to the same thing. But in terms of the capacity, that I suspect there could be the capacity in the system. It's not a straightforward system. It is quite a complicated area, quite a complicated body and area of law. So you're quite right. It does need people who are familiar with and expert in those areas to work in it.
Graham, you wanted to come in.
Thanks, Chair. Good morning, Mr. Kirkpatrick, and thanks for giving evidence today. I appreciate you haven't been in post very a very long time, but I was interested in some of your earlier responses, and in particular the fact that the EHRC shares concerns about the impact of closures of ticket offices on the particularly on disabled passengers. I wonder if I might ask you about an earlier letter that the EHRC wrote to the Transport Committee. I don't know if it's fair to ask, but perhaps you could find out for me. The chair, this is in 2019, the chair of the EHRC wrote to the committee. In fact, the chair of the Select Committee then was Hugh Merriman. And in that letter, it stated that the impact of ongoing transport policies remains a concern, in particular the move to driver-only operated trains, as well as reductions in staffed stations. We believe that the shift to driver-only operated trains, with the increased likelihood of there being no second member of staff on board to assist disabled passengers, and a decrease in staffed stations, could represent a diminution of protection for disabled people and potentially be a breach of the Equalities Act 2010. Has anything changed since that opinion was given to the committee in 2019?
I think what lies behind that opinion is the view, which would be the same as expressed there and as we expressed to the consultation on ticket offices, that when steps of that kind are contemplated, our view is what is most important is that the authorities involved properly think through whether they have understood the equalities implications of all of those.
As you understand how the system works, ministers, the Department for Transport, are pressurising the train operating companies to reduce costs. Train operating companies are trying to reduce costs by reducing staffing levels, closing ticket offices, reducing staff on stations, and in reducing driver-only operated trains. But ministers and others must be aware of their obligations under the Equalities Act, and I hope that you and your colleagues will point that out in no uncertain terms to them.
We agree. We do consider it our responsibility to remind ministers in this and other fields if we think there is a danger that they are not fulfilling their equality obligations properly. And we have written to a number of different ministers, not just in transport but in other departments of state at different times, asking them that question. To be clear, and I think this is absolutely consistent with what you said, our ambition is to make sure they've thought through the equalities implications properly and are making such changes as they want to make for whatever reason in a way that takes those properly into account and doesn't give rise to disproportionate harm to particular groups in the population. I think that's our obligation, and that's the obligation we continue to seek to fulfil.
I understand, and thank you for sharing that view with the committee. I'd be grateful if you could check with colleagues when you're reviewing your strategic objectives, if you could clarify that the position remains the same as it was in 2019, as the committee were informed by letter. Thanks, Chair.
Thank you. Carl, you had a quick supplementary one too.
Yeah, that's all right, very quickly. So you've not been in your position very long. How long has your chief executive been in position since he left IPSA?
He would have been in place for about 2.5-3 years, something of that order.
Okay, if you pass the message back next time you're in front of us, we'd like to see the Chief Executive.
The Chief Executive is currently unwell,
understood.
I'm afraid, which is why you've got me, but I hear the message, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. If I could just conclude this part of the session with a fairly general but important question. We've heard considerable evidence that the experience of disabled people travelling is poor and has got worse since the pandemic. You've said it is a complex area of law. Our main exam question in this inquiry is to determine, is there sufficient legislation and regulations in place, and therefore it's a question of enforcement, or are there gaps? Do you think the Equality Act is the right place for transport rights to be enshrined?
We don't have a strong view on that. We are not aware of gaps. We believe that it is possible to act under the regulations and, as a fallback, potentially under the Equality Act. where we are able to and where we and where we need to. So we don't have a shopping list of changes to the law to offer to the committee. The Equality Act is a big, broad-ranging piece of legislation, which deliberately, it was a very consolidatory piece, kind of draws together multiple duties, multiple protective characteristics and so forth. Carving bits out of that would have consequences, which I think would need to be thought about fairly carefully, because that the coherence of that broad legal framework seems to us to have some value. But that's not to say that there isn't a case for doing things in a different way. As I say, we do not see a compelling argument that there are gaps now that need to be filled.
Thank you. That's very helpful, and I'm not sure what our conclusions will be, but that's the question we're trying to answer through this inquiry. May I thank you for your time and evidence this morning.
Thank you.
And could I ask the second panel to come forward, please? Welcome to our second panel. Usually at this stage in proceedings we have a minister to join us, but we have a richness of ministers. I'm not sure what the collective term for ministers is.
Very brave. Come up with
ideas.
You get
a very mixed all answer day. To that question, I think.
But for the purposes of our records, could I please invite you all to state your name and positions, please. I'll start with Liz on my left.
Hi, my name is Liz Wilson. I am the Deputy Director at the Department for Transport with responsibility for accessibility and inclusive travel.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Guy Opperman. I'm the Member of Parliament for Hexham and I am a Minister at the Department for Transport. I look after roads, buses, active travel, and I am the accessibility lead in the department.
Thank you.
Good morning, Chair. I'm Hugh Merriman. I'm the Minister for Rail and HS2.
Thank you.
Good morning, Chair. I'm Anthony Brown. I'm the Minister for Aviation and Decarbonisation of Transport and Technology.
Thank you. We are grateful for your time this morning. Guy, if I could perhaps start with you, given you have, as you say, sort of lead responsibility in the Department for these issues. You are relatively new in position, which gives you an opportunity to look at these issues with fresh eyes. What would you say is working well in terms of accessibility, and where is there room for improvement?
So, it is a pleasure to do this job. I asked to do this job. I took a demotion from Minister of State to Parliamentary Undersecretary to do this, and I welcome the inquiry because I think it is needed, it is appropriate, and I welcome the exam question you just posed to the EHRC because I think it is the right exam question. As the lead departmental minister, I have begun a process in day 30 of this particular job to try and assess where we are and to try and have a look at the overview of this. To be fair, the Secretary of State provides very strong leadership in this particular space, and I'll come on to that in detail. I come from a personal standpoint where my mother is disabled and requires a wheelchair, and I fully that's not true. I don't fully understand the implications of what accessibility is for all people who've heard in evidence, but I have a degree of comprehension because of that. I also have a 20-year legal career challenging public authorities and sometimes representing them. From my last client was Ed Balls when I was a barrister, but obviously I spent most of my time as a human rights lawyer and a public law lawyer challenging public authorities as to accessibility and things like that. My take is that we are doing well, but could significantly better. And I think there is much that we can change going forward. I think that the department has individual areas where it is making real progress, But there is a danger in every department, in every bit of government, of being in silos and other bit of it not being an all-pervasive attitude to that department. Now, that is my very preliminary 30-day assessment, and that's not a criticism of individual civil servants, ministers, previous portfolio holders. That is merely how do we make accessibility and the rights of the disabled something that is fundamental to the whole delivery of this department, and that is what we need to try and do.
Thank you. Now, in the course of this inquiry, we've heard individual bits of evidence from witnesses. We've also conducted a survey where members of the public have shared with us their experiences. The position's not good. You know, nearly 90% of people who've responded have told us that they have challenges. And a particularly alarming evidence is that since the pandemic, things are getting worse, not better. What areas are you going to focus on initially to try and remedy that situation?
I think you are right, is my take, that the evidence certainly, and it's not for me to assess the individual department, but the evidence that I have read, particularly in the first session in, I think it's the 23rd of June, was pretty overwhelming that COVID had a negative impact in a whole form of ways, and we need to make up for that. I think if I could, I wrote three words down, which are attitude, integration, and ownership. I think attitude is ensuring that all providers, and that's not just the department, but all providers, have a can-do, proactive attitude would go to a massive step forward. It really, really would. And I look at the evidence of Stephen Anderson and Christiane, and I look at what they said towards the end of your first session, which I read twice, and it was overwhelming that attitude changes across the board is a positive thing. And that doesn't require legislation, that requires a mindset. The second is integration. I can only speak for my piece, but it is ensuring in every aspect, from how you design a housing estate to how you drive forward transport infrastructure, that all aspects are considered. And that includes active travel, that includes accessibility, and that these are not things that are added on at the end or considered as a last minute. That integration of services as provided by the state in all its shapes and forms surely is key. And that again is a ministerial direction. And the final bit is ownership. And it's not for me to comment on previous regulators, previous people who gave evidence here just now. That's for you to comment. But I think owning the problem is the most important thing. And saying, sticking your hand up and saying, this is in my wheelhouse, I own this problem, is utterly key in all aspects of government and regulatory process.
Thank you. Final question from me for the moment before I pass to colleagues. As you've alluded to, our sort of central question is, are there gaps in the legislation? Or is it primarily an enforcement and, as you say, attitude issue? From what you've seen thus far, are there gaps that in legislation that we need to fill?
I think we'll probably come on to things like an Accessibility Act in a bit more detail and at greater length, but my take is no, not at present. But I don't rule it out, is the genuine point. There is some very telling evidence, I'll find it later on, about the assessment of why the Equalities Act was brought into and the purpose behind the Equality Act. And I can't remember off the top of my head who gave that particular evidence, but they spoke very eloquently about how that was meant to simplify the process. Trying to introduce a new act to simplify the process doesn't necessarily get the outcome and that you're seeking. What I do think is we have to make the system in all its shapes and forms work better. That is patently clear, all right? And I accept that challenge, and if I have any influence on the department and on the various regulators that we're all overseeing, which individual ministers are looking after, acceptance of that challenge and driving forward attitudinal change is surely key. Make the system work better. Now, there is a legitimate point, which you probably will raise with me, about individual aspects of individual pieces of legislation where there may be tweaks, whether it is taxis or e-scooters or whatever it is. One can have a chat about that and say, are there individual tweaks that need to be made in individual bits of legislation? But fundamentally, own the problem, run it better, and have a change of an attitude.
Thank you. Sarah, you wanted a quick supplementary.
A really quick one on that. So the Inclusive Transport Strategy has a target for 2030. Now, given what's happened with the pandemic, do you still believe that you can meet that target of 2030?
Yes. I can give you the long political answer, but yes, I do believe that actually. And there are a number of, if I can just amplify briefly, Chair, there are a number of key reasons why, which all of us can give evidence on, but the fundamental is this. There are, I think, 91 metrics in that. I have what in departmental terms they call a Gantt chart, what you and I would call a flow chart of, are we achieving what we're trying to achieve? And in 2024, we will publish a proper audit of that, similar to what the Select Committee is trying to do in terms of auditing government. But I think having an assessment of the ITS, of having a real published assessment of where we are going on this, is a proper thing. There may be isolated elements where there is difficulty on that. A good example is lifts in every single railway station or whatever. You can go through on its specific isolated areas where in my most remote rural station in the world, Hugh is much more expert on this, there may be problems getting to 2030 on this, all right? But fundamentally, there are things that are changing on that, and the key change, which Select Committee is aware of, is obviously the changes in respect of HS2, the transformation of funding through Network North, and the money that will be made available as a consequence of that, which is new money in this space, which particularly in the mayoralty regions can be utilised to make a big difference in delivering the ITS. So my answer is yes, there may be isolated exceptions, but also come 2024, we still have 6 years to fix it. Most of a large proportion of the 91 objectives, and it is a strategy, but you've still got to deliver it, have been achieved or are being achieved.
Fabian.
Do you agree that accessibility failures on our public transport networks are completely unacceptable? They're not just an indicator of poor customer service, but they are unacceptable. And when there are good access facilities, often they don't work for lack of investment or maintenance. What's your view on that?
Who are you directing that to? I'm happy
all
to...
All of you.
Shall I start and others, colleagues can come in? So the answer to your question is yes, fundamentally. And I don't think there's a single person in the room who would disagree with the fundamental premise that we want to make this the best possible experience and that we are all on a journey, forgive the pun, that needs to be much improved, all right? And where there are failures, one would sincerely hope that they are brought to the attention of those who are responsible and then action is taken. So I don't think anybody would disagree with the fundamental premise.
Perhaps if I can just add from a rail perspective when it comes to lifts, for the next control period 7, which will commence in April 2024, the sort of maintenance and delivery of lifts is actually one of the key requirements for Network Rail. So it's recognised across the rail sector that there's more we need to do. A number of MPs in this place have taken that up directly with me, and it will actually become a key priority for Network Rail for the next five-year period.
Let me just interrupt you and say I'm glad to hear that. Last summer, early autumn, I was at a remote station in Bradford, and there were two people stuck in a lift. They were absolutely trapped. The doors didn't work. I couldn't get them out. They didn't get a response from the emergency helpline. They rang, and there was no reply, just an answering service. That's surely unacceptable. And isn't there a dilemma here between the need for train operating companies, to cut costs and increase profit, and the maintenance they absolutely have to have for things like lifts to stop people getting stuck in them? They were stuck in those lifts for about an hour.
You're absolutely right, Mr. Hamilton. It's not good enough, and that's why we have got that focus. And it's also important that as well as delivering more step-free stations, we also ensure that the ones we've got are properly maintained as well. And I think that's absolutely right to get that focus. To your point in terms of the profit element, the way that railway works now, post-COVID, post-franchising, is that the costs are provided by the Department for Transport for the train operators to run the services, and all the revenue is then collected back by the department. So it won't have an element of profit sort of increment in that regard. And all of our contracts actually have performance fee elements to it. So if the service isn't good enough, and that includes the entire service, then that fee won't get earned either.
I'd like to put on the record that I agree it's completely unacceptable if disabled people can't travel without without having problems. I'm completely committed to the 2030 target, you know, ideally beforehand, of disabled people being able to travel with confidence. And then the aviation industry, Mr. Opperman mentioned his mother. My father also needs a wheelchair going through airports. I've taken one of my children through an airport on a wheelchair through Heathrow. It has to be said, the experience was exemplary, but I know the issues that people can face. I mean, the government has done a lot. The airports have done a lot. The airlines have done a lot. You've had an evidence session on this before, but we clearly do need to do more. One of the questions was, do we need legislation on it? We did actually publish early this year a response to the Aviation Consumer Policy Reform Consultation, where we said when parliamentary time allows, we would like legislation to be able to give the CAA better enforcement powers. At the moment, we've got very good guidance. We've got quite a good framework. But actually, there is a problem with enforcement, and that would enable it to issue fines to companies that breach that don't live up to their guidelines, and also to have to introduce mandatory alternative dispute resolution mechanism, so that when people have complaints, they will always have somewhere to go to. It's a voluntary scheme at the moment, and also to remove the cap on compensation for mobility damage to wheelchairs and mobility chairs. At the moment, there's a cap under the Montreal Protocol that we can't go above, so we actually need legislation for that. But the other thing that I'd like to see is the Civil Aviation Authority currently has an airport accessibility framework forum, which is where they actually monitor what all the airports do. They're quite sort of close inspection. They provide statistics of whether they how they're doing as well. And I think you heard this in the oral evidence from the airline industry that I think there's one airport that still needs improvement, but it has come a long way. But I think we could do a similar sort of framework for the airlines. It's more complex because there's 100 airlines come to the UK, and obviously they're not all UK airlines. So I think it would be really good to have the same sort of scrutiny and pressure put on the airlines, because a lot of the stories that we hear that come to the media about people being stuck on planes for hours, not being able to get off, clearly totally unacceptable. And those stories have been, it's the airlines that have and that haven't been communicating well with dealing with it well and with the airports.
Yes. Thank you, Chairman. I'm going to ask all four of you. Some of you who are here might have heard me being mildly critical of our previous witness. Ladies first, followed by I'm going to make the ministers work, alphabetical on your surnames. The question is, do you think that they should remain at arm's length as it seems it is, or should they back off completely, or should they help the various departments by getting their hands dirty and enforcing what
the
government's
EHRC
trying to do
in particular? I think there is. I think we do need to think about how the regulators work together collectively, and how the EHRC are working with the regulators, but also how the regulators work together. And I think we should look at opportunities to see what collaboration and cooperation there is. I think that there are examples internationally and also in other sectors where there is cross-cutting issues and regulators come together, and I think it's something that we would like to think about a bit more.
Yeah, there's 218 staff, I think, and quite a large budget. I'm just picking on them at the moment, but
yeah.
within the realms of things, I think that's actually quite a large organisation, and you'd have hoped that transport would still be a strategic aim of theirs, but they've knocked that back for whatever reason.
Indeed.
Yeah, sorry, Anthony.
Thank you. And in week four of the job, I haven't got much experience of EHRC and how they operate within the aviation sector. And as I said, the main issue in aviation is There is lots of guidance out there, really quite detailed guidance. It's about enforcement of it, and it's in the aviation sector, it's the CAA that has the primary role of enforcement, but it just doesn't have the tools, and we need to give them the tools. But you know, how they would interact with the EHRC, I'm not, in terms of enforcement, I'm not actually cited on that.
Okay. Hugh, and welcome back to something that you started, full circle.
Yes, yes, I know. It was actually one of the last inquiries that we commissioned when I was chair, and I didn't expect to be sitting here. I expect to be sitting where the chair is. I think it's a really interesting point, one that we do need to look at, and I think as a result of this inquiry, looking through the various sort of patchwork of rules and legislation, of course, we have the Equalities Act, Public Sector Equalities Duty, and there that's where you see the EHRC. And then on the rail side, we have the Railways Act, which gives the powers to the regulator, the Office of Rail and Road, to then deliver their powers. So you have got, in effect, you've got two opportunities in that particular way. And there was one case recently with LNER where it was the EHRC that ended up in detail and actually signing a legal agreement with the Australian operator rather than the ORR. But I would expect the ORR to make sure that everything that's revealed on that particular equalities side is then followed up from a railway's licensing and powers part. So I think we could probably do more, as Liz says, to join it together.
Thank you. Guy?
You're not backwards coming forward, so I'm not going to be either. I'm going to lean in. I listened to the evidence. I have looked at the evidence, albeit I'm only day 30. I manifestly think the EHRC should be doing more. I would refer you to the answer at question 286 on the October 25th evidence, where Caroline Strickland very strongly gave that view. I endorse it 110%. I didn't know the large number of personnel at this august organisation, and they do have a very broad remit. No one disputes that. And I get why they may have decided other things as a operational decision. And again, all of us had to make decisions in COVID and post-COVID as to what were the operational priorities. All of that is given. But going forward, could they do more? Unquestionably, yes. And should they? Yes.
Super. Thank you very much indeed for that.
Back to you, Chairman.
Me. Yeah. Turn to you next.
Yeah, good morning, panel. My question is, what is the department's ambition for accessibility to transport infrastructure and vehicles across the mole? And is there a practical roadmap for getting to 100%, whether that is defined as travelling with or without assistance?
I take that. So the answer is, does the department have a plan? Yes. Is it set out in detail? Yes. Is there a copy of it here? Yes, it is. This is the Inclusive Transport Strategy. It has, as you can see, it's a very slim document. It sets it out in great detail. We have a metric, though, which we're judging ourselves, and in 2024 we'll do a full published report of it, which obviously we would share with the committee and would hope the committee would then make an assessment of whether they agree or disagree on that. So I think the answer is yes, yes, and yes.
Any comments from the other members of the panel?
No, nothing further to add.
Okay, just a supplementary then. Do you accept that under the UN Convention on the Rights for Disabled People, that disabled people have the right to independent living, including being able to travel spontaneously? And how are you making that a reality in your remit?
The answer is, of course, yes, we do. And that was passed, I think, I'll be corrected if I'm wrong, around about 2016. The ITS is 2018 and takes all of the points that are made, sets it out in copious detail how we're trying to address that, and is in a position that I would like to think we are going to do those points. Now, there is legitimate criticism in isolated areas where there are either gaps in the system or we're not driving things forward as fast as we can. We take that on board, and we're all of us collectively, both as civil servants, as regulators and as ministers, trying to address that.
Graham.
Thanks, Chair. Good morning, panel. I wonder if I might ask Minister Opperman, just following on from questions from my colleague, you were waving a copy of the department's inclusive transport strategy there, and I'm quite interested. Could you mentioned there were going to be metrics to measure success and so on, and you'll be coming back to the committee to tell us about that. But can you point to some specific example within your remit of where the department's inclusive policy has paid dividends, a particular example? I want to ask each minister in turn.
Sure. I mean, if I may, what I would love to do is I'd like to give you a written answer, because it's not fair to say there are 91 separate objectives.
I don't want 91.
I didn't think you would, and I could read it out at great length. But I mean, I think genuinely what you should do is you should say, see what the 91 are and then see where we are. If I give a few, clearly, Hugh, I suspect, will talk about the Rail Ombudsman, the Passenger Assist App, the It's Everyone Journey campaign, guidance on taxi licensing, the PSBAR regulations and the funding that follows. I could go on. There are individual things. Is there more to do? Yes, there is. But I genuinely look at the strategy, look at what has been delivered, and look at what is still a journey.
I mean, some of these are incredibly positive steps, but not all. Some of them are ambitions. You know, the Passenger Assist app, we've had lots of feedback to say that it's far from satisfactory at the way it's operating currently. But no, I'm grateful for your answer. I wonder if I might ask Minister Merriman the same question.
Thank you, Mr. Morris. So yes, actually, that is an example. So the Passenger Assist app now has allowed for the turn up and go with a 2-hour booking period. It used to be 24 hours. I know this committee have been critical of that policy, so that's down to 2 hours now. In terms of satisfaction, the ORR's last survey on this showed that there was a 90% satisfaction rate, up from 87% the previous year. So we're getting there. And in terms of stations, 75% of journeys are at sort of step-free stations. So even though most stations are not step-free, the busy stations are. And so we've got that figure at 75%, used to be 50%. So again, improvements there. And if you look at Network Rail, who deliver 40% of all journeys, 60% of those are booked and 40% aren't booked, because people can turn up and go because the staff are there at the stations, the lifts are there as well. So I believe that's progress. And then the final thing I was going to touch on is the really important is the Rail Ombudsman. So complaints always get taken up with the train operator, but now the Rail Ombudsman can intervene and has intervened and has the powers to enforce. And again, that's all come from the inclusive transport strategy. We have delivered 2/3 of the requirements under that strategy, but there is more to do.
Thanks. I wonder if I might just pick up on one of those answers, Jeff, if I may. In the trajectory, the vision, no one can argue with about improving from 24 hours to book passenger assist to 2 hours, and assistance being available to passengers with disability. In my constituency, we have two railway stations which are unmanned, but there's quite a number of stations across the network which are manned stations which are currently operating at below optimum staffing levels. So staff aren't available readily to assist passengers with disabilities. Can I ask the Rail Minister if he has any further information on current levels of unfilled vacancies, and what steps he's taken to persuade the train operating companies to ensure that stations are fully and properly staffed?
So I will write to you with that information in terms of vacancy rates. You are right, there have been vacancies at stations. In terms of the requirements which would fall under the accessible travel policy that all station and the train operators are required to sign up to as part of the licensing powers from the ORR, I'll need to be in touch with the ORR in terms of whether they believe that any of that is not just a vacancy but also actually constitutes, in their view, a difficulty with compliance with that policy.
Will you be reminding them of that obligation?
Yeah, absolutely. I speak to the train operator managing directors on a regular basis. Matters come up, and I'll certainly make sure that that's there as well, Mr. Morris.
Can I just come in on that? As only 30 days ago, I was the employment minister, whose specific job at the Department of Work and Pensions was to try and fill such gaps. There is a massive role for the local job centre and the individual local rail operator to work together to try and create a skills boot camp or a sector-based work academy to try and fill the gaps. That there are vacancies across the sector is patently clear. I am doing a ginormous piece of work to try and fill bus driver vacancies and have been doing that for some considerable period of time. The DWP and the individual organisations are working together. Could we do more? Yes. But we unquestionably are trying to fill those, to address those problems.
Minister, I'm grateful for your intervention there, but you realise there's a financial incentive for the train operating companies not to fill vacancies. It reduces their costs. And where staff have been reduced, where staff have left, if they can function on a minimal service without any ministerial pressure or pressure from the regulator, they'll do that because they're under financial pressures on their bottom line. I'm just seeking to gently remind you that they have other obligations and obligations to disabled passengers, that they should fully staff the stations in accordance with the terms of their
license. I accept the point that you wish to make, but I also make the point that government, in a cross-departmental way, is trying to address any ability to fill the gaps, and there is work we're doing.
There is a challenge, because the funding going into the railway by the UK taxpayer has been £32 billion. Since COVID, whereas years gone back, actually the train operators paid money into the UK taxpayer. So we have to get that balance right between looking at costs, making sure that we're efficient, but at the same time ensuring that there is compliance with the accessible travel policy. And I understand that there is that tension there, but the requirement for all operators to comply with the accessible travel policy is absolute. So if it gets to a level that you are alluding to, where that is not being complied with, then that's where the Office of Rail and Road will take action. I don't believe that there is at that level at the moment, but I will find out and come back to you.
I believe it's about 11%, but you might check that. I wonder if I might ask Minister Brown if he could give me an example from his portfolio.
Of improvements? Of
An example of where the department's inclusive transport strategy, a specific example where it's paid a dividend for people with disabilities.
Well, it's we've done, as I say, there's actually a legal requirement under the EC regulation 1107/2006. Which has produced guidance, which has transformed what all airports do and airlines do in terms of helping disabled people. So they have, the airports have teams now of people. They prefer pre-notification. So they got, if somebody is arriving in a wheelchair, they prefer no in advance. But they had 3.5 million pre-notifications, and then they will help people. You know, all cases are different. All disabilities are slightly different, but they'll give appropriate help to them to help them get. From however they're arriving at the airport, through the check-in desk, through security. Often, it'll be in a wheelchair, and somebody will actually push the wheelchair through immigration, and then deliver to the to the plane. And then at the plane, the responsibility goes over to the airline, and the airlines have a range of different things, but they're required to have. That they should have wheelchairs that you can use within the aisles to help people get to the toilets. And so all this has, as I mentioned, the CAA, they do close scrutiny and monitoring of the airports and what they do. And the number of airports that they deemed inadequate, a few years ago it was 12, it's now down to one. So there's definitely been improvement, but we clearly can do a lot more. And they need more powers to be able to enforce more. But I think the overall experience has improved.
Recently, as part of our HS2 scrutiny, the committee visited Birmingham International Airport to see the HS2 station and the works that were going on there, and it was it did point out to us some of the improvements, including the access for disabled passengers, but the standards from airport to airport vary enormously.
They do, yeah.
And if the department's aware of that and seeking to level up a performance, that would be much appreciated. Can I just have one more question to Minister Opperman, and you mentioned that you would twice, in fact, you'd reviewed the evidence to the committee from the Disabled Passengers Transport Advisory Committee and the witnesses that we've heard here giving very powerful testimony. Can you tell the committee a little bit about how you work with the Disabled Passengers Transport Advisory Committee, and whether there are specific policy decisions and I don't want to put words into your mouth, but I'm thinking here about ticket office closures, where the department have promoted a policy that clearly was at odds with the views of disabled passengers on this forum.
Wow, there's about six questions in there, and I'll endeavour to unpick them as best I possibly can. It's all right, bear with me. I'll try and address the particular point. So I think it starts from the Secretary of State, who has made it a priority to include DIPTAC as part of the department. He took Professor Matt Campbell-Hill with him to the G7 summit in Japan on sustainable and accessible travel. I think there is no doubt, I spoke at length yesterday to Matt to have a discussion about the evidence today. I think there is, and I'll let Liz come in a second because she's the civil servant who's been looking at this in a much more wider context and can probably give you a much more balanced view over a period of time. But there is no doubt that DIPTAC is an integral part of the Department for Transport. I do think that we can do more to include them in, at the very least, it's not a question of being consulted, it's being part of the decision-making process when decisions are made. And I'm looking at a particular example on a footbridge slash crossing to a road at the present stage that I'm very much want their view on and their opinions on before I make a decision. And I think we need to have a very positive attitude to that. I'll leave Hugh to touch on specifics of ticket offices because he's way more specific on that. But my view is that they are integral to the department, and there is no doubt about that. If you read the inclusive transport strategy, the key passage comes from the DIPTAC lead, all right? And that is something that is utterly written hand in glove with them. Now, could we be better at doing this? Yes, I'm sure we could. But at the same stage, are they part of the department 110%? Yes, they are. Liz, do you want to come in? I'll let her come in.
Absolutely. DIPTAC has been there since 1985, and we've been working with them for a long time on big policy issues. I think we've, since Matt Campbell-Hill became the chair, we've been thinking about the systems and structures around that so that we absolutely do what the Minister said and make sure we're bringing them in right across the piece. So I think there's a long history of getting DIPTAC involved in accessibility-specific areas of work, and I'm sure the Minister will talk about their role in ticket office closures as part of that, and the ITS. I think where we want to move to is making sure that they are absolutely involved in all aspects of the policy that we're developing, where there may be an accessibility implication, even if it's not an accessibility specific policy area. We have been developing jointly with DIPTAC a forward work plan for them where we look at what are the big policy decisions coming up over the next 18 months and how and when are DIPTAC going to be able to be involved in that. How often do they need to be giving our views, and how are we responding to them so that where we are almost not able to take forward some of the things that they've suggested, we've got a clear dialogue on that. So I think we have a very, very constructive relationship with them. We've got a number of working groups sitting underneath that as well. And they're also very actively involved, not just through the main committees, but where we have ongoing working relationships with them on the big ticket accessibility policy areas, like the development of that's going on NRAS on rail at the moment. They're integrated into that. So I agree with the Minister, they're very much embedded into our thinking, but I think we would like to see that improve even more.
Can I go one point further, which is every minister will have to make decisions on a whole host of projects, all right, particularly in rail projects, road projects, buses and everything like that, some of which will have direct implications in terms of accessibility. But whether you're going to improve the M4 or whatever, that doesn't necessarily have it. What I think you have to have as a department, though, is that when you are making spending commitments in particular, that those are that there is proper understanding of issues of accessibility. And I don't just say accessibility. The key word I tried to use at the start, aside from attitude, was integration. Try to bring the different elements of the Department for Transport, whether it is active travel or accessibility in all its forms, into the decision-making process so that you have an integrated transport system. That is what we're trying to achieve.
For example, talking buses. that we kind of take for granted in London. That, I must say, I have noticed you turning the volume down so you can hardly hear. But that would be a real boon. It's not the norm on many of the routes in our region.
We're doing something on that. I'm happy to write to you on that.
Thank you.
Chair, do you want me to cover the point about dip tax involvement in the ticket office?
Please, yes.
Because that came up from Mr. Morris's questioning. So they were heavily involved. The groups that represent those with protected characteristics were the groups that I met first of all when the consultation exercise was launched by the train operators. And Matt, as the dip tax lead, was instrumental in that. He provided not just a sounding board, but a critical friend, and helped us all the way through that process. We had three meetings in total with those groups, with Matt very much taking a lead with me. And he provided a lot of challenge, and he did an excellent job. And I think what was really important is once the ticket office closures were cancelled, then I met with Matt and the groups again to ensure that all of the good that had come out of the consultation exercise in terms of the challenges for those with characteristics and what more could be done, how we could do it better, we're now working on making sure that we take that and see what can be delivered. So it's not just a question of what he did during the consultation exercise. He's now doing more work to actually allow things to get better that have been identified. And that will help us where we're putting together the National Rail Accessibility Strategy, because we're trying to get one common sort of set of policies across train operations. Then he will also be instrumental in that, and he's also instrumental in the review we have at the moment on the eligibility criteria for the disabled person's rail card. So again, that work goes on. So I hope that just gives a flavour of the work that he does. I didn't know much about it before I became a minister, I have to be honest, through this committee. I work with him really closely, he's excellent, and that body really does have clout.
Good, glad to hear it. Thanks, Chair.
Thank you. Jack, we'll turn to you next.
Thank you, Chair. And just wanted to firstly ask Minister Opperman about the legislative framework of it, and you've touched already on this and some of the challenges there because of the lack of coherence and the multiple different pieces of legislation and guidance. So is the department doing more to look at how we can improve the coherence of that legislation and guidance?
There is a legitimate question raised by this committee, and it is a legitimate point that this department needs to do to assess whether across the board the delivery of statute and regulation is appropriate and then being enforced, as we've discussed in previous evidence sessions and as you discussed earlier today, is being done properly. And I think that is something that we are keen to do. I think that basically comes in the form of an assessment of the ITS in 2024. That process has already begun, though. So I confess I have not read it in the copious detail I would have liked to have done so, but I have a very detailed assessment of all 91 different objectives and as part of that strategy, many of which is regulation doing what it should be doing? Are we actually enforcing this, et cetera, et cetera? Bringing all that together is difficult, but the work is being done, yes.
Thank you. To Minister Merriman, I want to thank you for the help you've been giving with lift improvements at Longton Station particularly. But that has been very challenging, particularly with the local authority and Network Rail taking quite a long time to get that TCF money spent to make those enhancements. So what more do you think can be done to make that process easier so that we can get those accessibility improvements at some of those stations?
Yeah, and thanks, Mr. Berrison. I enjoyed the visit with you because I know you've campaigned to get that package delivered. And I think it's quite interesting where you see that package as part of a partnership with a local authority, perhaps either through the Towns Fund or Levelling Up Fund, then it tends to be a wider package. And the question is whether actually one piece of work starts and then actually can eat up too much of the money and then things are missed out. As a more general programme, the Access for All programme, which we've been running over the control period six, has allowed us to deliver more step-free stations. And so we're now up to 220 additional step-free stations from that programme. And we've been able to make modifications to 1,500 more. I think the big challenge for me, and it's a challenge that I take to Network Rail who deliver that programme, is to make sure that they've got the best people on it to really ensure we can deliver to cost. I've made the point that it's always a terrible thing when there's money wasted on railway projects, but when it's actually railway projects that deliver step-free access, it's intolerable, because it means that we can't go and do the next project. So I think the challenge for us is to how we deliver the next batch of stations. There are currently 300 stations under review for us to actually make the next year's determination. Then how can we deliver more of them and stretch the costing for it? So I'm concerned about the cost overruns on a number, which then do cause that impact. Obviously, the design standards in terms of ramps going up are not just particular to the railway, they're general design standards, and I know that is a challenge as well.
I wanted to ask you a little bit more about the access for Orphan, because the reason why in Longton's case we've gone through TCF is because the footfall wasn't sufficient for access for all funding to be eligible, and so, you know, whatever bid we'd have put in, we just wouldn't have secured the funding. So what more can be done, particularly for those less well used stations but have, you know, lots of potential provide a really important facility for local communities? What can be done to actually improve access at those smaller local stations, and is there more that could be done to try and make it easier to use other funds, in addition to the Access for All Fund, to actually deliver some of those improvements?
Yeah, so we've got 634 railway stations where there is step-free access, but that means we've got 1,941 where we don't. The larger stations, which with the greatest footfall, which is why we have 75% of all journeys step free, of course the larger ones are within that. In terms of the criteria, footfall is one of them, but we also look at age profile. So is it a station that serves a community that has a higher than average age demographic, disability characteristics as well? Are they particularly high in that area? Is it near to a hospital? Are we actually trying to do the entire line of route? So we look at a whole range of criteria when we make those decisions. In terms of actually, is there more we can do to look at the general sort of enhancements that are going on, then yes, and I believe we do. So there are also some examples where stations, as they actually receive improvements, then from Equalities Act, we're actually then required to put the step-free access in, because it's almost counting more towards a new. So we had one recent example where we had to lift up a footbridge in order to deliver overheads for an electrification project. And actually that was then classified as, from an equalities perspective, requiring the lifts to go in there. So actually that in a way is sort of a helpful way of actually delivering more to it. And I'm particularly interested in the enhancement programme that we have going from Network North, as to where we can ensure that the work that goes on at the stations, because we've got to deliver the stations, perhaps because of electrification projects signed off, that gives us the Access for All sign off as well.
Sarah.
Thank you, Chair. Minister Opperman, you just said about bringing accessibility issues overall in the department into the decision-making process, but we've seen examples of when rail infrastructure is being built or refurbished that actually some of the cost pressures or local objections have meant that we've actually seen derogations from the original plans, and accessibility requirements have been then overridden. Surely, and following on from this conversation, accessibility issues need to be priorities in these cases.
Yeah, so I remember with this committee, with its Trains Fit for the Future, had a recommendation that the sort of compliance for heavy rail must be met, because there was a commitment from 2010 that by 2019 all of the accessibility requirements would be enforced. And when the committee sat, that was still outstanding. Those were delivered in 2021. So the requirements are now there on heavy rail. I will write to you, because it's something that I've been discussing this morning and yesterday with officials as a result of this session, in terms of how that compliance is delivered in full. And to your point about derogations, because that's something that I've asked about as well. There is still an issue on light rail. But when, for example, London Underground are upgrading their rolling stock, so Bakerloo order is a good example of that, then that should actually be taken out. And the reason why we had a failure to comply when the committee sat, which was after 2019, was because of some rolling stock that came later on to Greater Anglia. So at that point, I think there were 525 vehicles that were still not compliant. That was delivered by the end of 2021. It was a committee recommendation for that to occur. But I'll write to the committee just setting out more detail in terms of what that compliance actually means.
Do you think then, as a department, there needs to be a bit more honesty about the priority of accessibility issues across stations rather than kind of promising change that can't always be delivered?
That's a fair challenge, and I think it's one of the things I've lent into when I got the sort of draft sort of skeleton of what we expected the National Rail Accessibility Strategy to look like, that the key deliverable for me is that all of this can be achieved within the budget that we've got. Because to your point, and I think it's something that I hope has been sort of put on me by my place on this committee, it's important that we stretch and set deadlines, but they have to be, and targets, but they have to be deliverable. And it's really important for ministers to set those targets on the basis that they'll still be there to justify whether they have or haven't been met. So yes, that is a fair point.
So, and Minister Opperman touched on it, when will the data be available for the station audits?
Yes, so the station audit is the audit every single one of our just over 2,500 stations has received. So I'm expecting, the first phase was doing the audit and then actually gathering all of the data. I myself am expecting a sort of presentation as to how we can, what we can do with that data, how it can inform us to make decisions, and then crucially, how we can put it in the public domain. So that's something I'll be looking to do with officials at the start of next year. I've already asked for a meeting to go in to do just that.
And when this data is released to the public, last time we just had the headline figures, will you be making sure that all of that data is released so that that can be scrutinised properly?
Yeah, absolutely, because there's no point doing an exercise like this if we're not actually going to publish what it tells us, and that's really important. That's important to me so that I can see it as well. Of course, there is a lot of published data already that tells you per station exactly what facilities are there. So I want to see how this can be done better and also in a manner that's straightforward for everyone to understand. So I'm really committed to that because it's been a passion of mine that, you know, the exercise is a great one. I went to Marylebone to actually see it being conducted and sort of joined it. But actually, I don't want that just to sort of be a written exercise. It's got to be something that's published and people can really utilise for the benefit of their travels.
I think it comes back to the honesty aspect as well for the public to be able to see what's happening. Are train station operators clear that they need to be able to turn up and go services for disabled passengers that haven't booked in advance? Because we did previously hear that that was not the case and that they just didn't have the capacity to be able to do that on railway stations.
Yeah, so for those where they are staffed, and all of the staff have a requirement, and again, that was under the inclusive transport strategy, to be properly trained up so that they can cater for needs. So that's an absolute requirement. So I would happily sort of take up matters where that hasn't sort of passed muster. And again, it's the Office of Rail and Roads' responsibility to take action in the event that the accessible policy has not been satisfactorily complied with, as well as a sort of rail ombudsman task as well. So I think you heard from the RR, there was only one example where they've ever delivered an enforcement notice, and that was in a rather peculiar situation where there was a disagreement over whether bike provision should be there over ramp provision. But that's unusual to get to that stage where a notice is actually delivered, because the RR and the train operators or Network Rail tend to work to provide a solution, because if that's not the case, then the fine can be quite considerable, 10% of the turnover.
Can I add one thing? And I accept you, the main questions were to Hugh, and rightly so, because it's rail matters, which is that there is no point having data unless you actually use it. A, publish it, but lots of data just gets published and forgotten about, with no disrespect, across all aspects of government. What I would hope is that what we would do is we would take the data and actually then learn from it, both as a department, because ministers come and go, governments come and go, but all of this journey that we're going to be on is going to be something for some considerable period of time. And the one lesson I would hope we would take from it above all else is that we integrate all aspects of DFT into the decision making and the procurement and then the delivery process. That does not always happen in the past. I cast no aspersions about individual projects or things, But what we need to do is we need to make sure that the department is thinking about all of these things together and then procuring and delivering. We save money in that way and we get better outcomes in that way. That is something that I think we can really learn from.
Fabian.
Thank you, Chair. I think this is, my questions are going to be addressed to all of you, actually. We know that technology is something that really affects all aspects of our lives, especially and increasingly in transport. And I'm wondering whether you could give your view as ministers on whether the legislative framework to protect passengers from the advance of technology that affects them directly is actually fit for purpose. For example, I gather next year we're going to be seeing CT scanners in airports. Are the public sufficiently protected by the legislative framework from any effects of the new technologies that are going to be impacting on their lives every single day? Mr. Brown.
Thank you, and a very pertinent question. So, yeah, on the specific of the new security scanners, yes, they're being introduced next year, and I know that the department's had a lot of thought about the impact that has on disabled passengers who have to go through security as well, and they might need to go through in a slightly different way, and I can write to you with details on exactly what's been going on there. One example of new technology, which you haven't asked about yet, but is coming down the line, is automated vehicles. I mean, self-driving cars, and legislation's gone to the House of Lords already and will be coming to Parliament, to the House of Commons next year. And we have been working with DipTac on that, about the implications that has on for disabled passengers, because some of them might be private vehicles, some of them might be taxis and so on. They'll have to be able to provide disabled passengers with a full service. So being able to get out of sometimes the human drivers provide part of the service, helping people get out of the wheelchair, into the car, etc. And so we're working through, the Law Commission did a report on automated vehicles, and they made 12 different accessibility outcome recommendations. I can list them all if you want, but it's basically to make sure that disabled passengers can have full access to these vehicles, and so we're in the legislation. We'll make sure there's a legal requirement on the designers of those vehicles to make sure that they are fully accessible to a range of different disabilities, and that is a sort of co-design process where disabled groups will be working with the designers to make sure that that disabled people can use those vehicles.
Thank you. We are looking at specifically at access, but may I just come back briefly on a question relating to cyclists, because I chair the All Party Cycling Group. We are very concerned about the effect of automated vehicles. Will that be included in the legislation?
Safety is absolutely paramount. Yeah, okay. I mean, it is the number one thing in the legislation is safety. And absolutely, vehicles. You know, ultimately, the move to automated vehicles, which I think is inevitable and it's coming, we're closer than most people realise, I'm confident, actually reduce the number of accidents, both for the people inside the vehicles, but also externally by cyclists.
Even if it helps, I have already attended the APPG reception. I've already accepted the next invite, I think, from yourself and Selene. Very happy to come and discuss it as active travel. It is an issue for us as well, which we want to make sure we work together, and certainly as a department we're on it.
Very much, Guy.
Anything to perhaps add? I'd just add, I know it's come up as to whether the accessible travel policies that the ORR has in place with any operator on the railway should be more prescriptive. I think part of the challenge when there is a prescriptive code is that she then doesn't take into account for new technologies. So I think in a way it's actually one of the benefits of actually having a general set of requirements, that where new technology comes in that can improve, then it means the ORR is in a more nimble, flexible position to be able to embrace it. Having said that, we are going through the iteration of the design standards for accessible rail stations, so that consultation has just ended. And that will also allow us to actually take into account new technologies which wouldn't have existed the last time that standard was put together.
Can I just add one final thing, which is two points. First of all, I'd recommend very strongly the answer at question 66 by Alan Benson, who gave a great example of tech providing the video tour of TransPennine, which is clearly not that expensive, but it is tremendously enabling to a particular passenger. That sort of tech is not too expensive, but tremendously empowering. And I think one of the challenges for all of us in our individual portfolios and collectively as a department is how can we take everything from progressive tech to AI learning and then apply it to the individual challenges we have. And there are good examples out there. I think we need to look also internationally at who is doing good stuff in this space, and there is plenty to learn, and there is plenty that is of massive assistance that is not too expensive either and can be implemented quite quickly. And all suggestions gratefully received, but I looked at that, the answer to the question at the end of the first day, and I thought that's a fantastic example of a tech example really driving forward real change.
Well, thanks for raising that. And I said something very important there, and that is that we can learn from what other countries are doing. And I'm glad to hear you say that, because so often we try and reinvent the wheel.
Of course.
Very appropriate in public transport, of course, but it's important that we actually learn from the very best practices. So, well done.
I was going to make a comment there that I know in your inquiries lots of people have mentioned Canada. My wife is Canadian, as it happens, so I spend a lot of time there. And it is very noticeable that you see a lot more people in wheelchairs around in Canada than you do in the UK. And partly that is because they've spent more time over the years designing buildings. They've got a lot more new buildings. We've got a lot of older buildings. But really think about accessibility from the outset, and you just noticeably, visibly see it.
One really good example that's going on at the moment is in Doncaster, where the passenger information boards per train platform, you see the whole board there, and often you'll get a passenger announcement telling you what's going on that platform, have there been any changes. But obviously for those that have a hearing loss, that doesn't work for them. There's a video of someone signing on each particular board.
Really?
And it's a trial, and it's been put in Doncaster. And that's the type of innovation that we like to see, and we then like to see rolled out where it can be.
Well, next time tomorrow when I get the train back to Leeds, I'll have a look out of the window when we stop at Donny.
It would be, yeah, your area.
Thanks for that.
Can I just mention one other technological advance on the aviation side that the industry is looking at is the ideal solution would be for people in wheelchairs to be able to sit in the plane in their wheelchairs and for it to be fully safe. I mean, that does happen a bit, but actually they're looking at new types of wheelchair that can basically lock in automatically into the plane and provide the full safety. And I know that is something that it doesn't sound that overly complicated to do, but you need to design it in there, and it is a new form of technology that isn't used currently.
Thank you.
Just before I turn to Gavin, just one supplementary, Mr. Brown, on the new scanners that are coming in at airports. A couple of weeks ago, my colleagues visited Birmingham Airport, which is one of the airports where these new scanners will be coming in. And I should add, I've got a oral question on this tomorrow morning.
So
if you can't answer now, you've got 24 hours to come up with it. There's no problem with, they've got no objection to the new scanners coming in. They think it'll be a great help. But there is a concern that requiring every passenger to go through it straight away could lead to problems. I'm just wondering, in terms of the accessibility angle of this, would it be worth piloting this in a couple of areas first? So any unintended consequences can be examined before the system as a whole.
We clearly have to be pragmatic about it, but on the specifics of that, I can write to you, but I can also give you an oral answer tomorrow.
I look forward to it. Thank you. Gavin.
Thanks so much, Chair. I'm going to drill down a bit more into the regulators, which we've obviously been discussing a fair amount, but just before I do so, if I can come to yourself, Mr. Minister Opperman, in the survey that we put out to the public prior to the start of this inquiry, of the people who've complained about accessibility issues, barriers, 63% have never received a satisfactory response. Of those who've complained once, 82% have never received or didn't receive a satisfactory response. Now, bear in mind that in the survey, only 1.7% of the respondents said they'd never experienced any barriers. Then you look at the fact that 43% have never actually bothered to complain, presumably because they felt it was pointless to complain if you look at the experience of everyone else. Surely, because what we think about accessibility issues and what the DfT thinks about, it means nothing compared to those who are trying to access transport. So whilst I hear you're open to potential looking at legislation, do you think it's a legislative issue or is it a regulatory and enforcement issue that these passengers are facing?
Sure. So their experience is noted and not acceptable, and we need to make that utterly clear. The question is, what do we do to address it? I'm yet to be persuaded that a new Act of Parliament is necessarily going to institute the specific change. And if you look at the evidence late on in the third session, the witnesses were very clear on that particular point. The bit I think that we need to do is we need to change attitudes. There was sadly, some very compelling evidence of some of the inappropriate comments by, for example, some bus drivers and some individuals that you heard. We need to change the implementation so that then actually when regulators are in charge, they actually do the job they're meant to do. We all heard the evidence you heard first thing this morning. You will draw your own conclusions on that. But I also think there is a wider thing, which is, and it is quite clear from the evidence you've heard, that it is getting yourself heard when something does not go right is very difficult. That in whatever shape or form, whether that is a civil remedy or a criminal remedy or it is a regulator stepping in, that is not easy. And that has got to change, in my humble opinion. Now, there are ways that we can do this in the sense of the individual departments, and it's a cross-government thing, look at this. But I would hope that we would look at this, go away, and then come up with realistic solutions to dramatically improve the experience for those persons.
Okay, and so let's look at the experience or the enforcement action taken by regulators. We all have different powers and different levels of powers, but some of the regulators don't have the powers at the moment to properly enforce, as we've heard from many people. And some don't have the inclination to use the powers that they actually do have. So how will you fix that in terms of the regulators?
Well, I think there is the power to take action in a whole variety of ways across the piece. Just let me finish. I'm very happy to look into, and I have started the process of looking into, whether there are genuine gaps in the reporting process and then the action process. Do I think the EHRC need to do a lot more? Yes, I do, unquestionably. I don't think I could have lent in any further to Carl McCartney's question. But I do think that there is a lot that we can do as ministers to hold regulators to account. That is what we are trying to do, and I'm quite sure this team is going to do that very robustly.
As indicated already, clearly the different regulators, be it ORR, CAA, etc., which Minister Brown mentioned earlier, and I'll come back to him on, have different levels of power. Some are seeking extra powers to be able to do their job a lot better. But should there be, without an overarching legislation, should there be a standardisation of enforcement powers of the transport regulators across the modes?
The answer with standardisation is, bear with me because it's a slightly more complex, devolution features very strongly in this. So,
big fan.
Yeah, well, I'm, of course you are. But, but here's a serious point, right? So we as the Westminster government are devolving, some people would say not as much as they would like, an awful lot of power. And there's a lot more that's going to flow with the 2024 mayoralty elections, and huge amounts of transport powers are going to local mayors, and there's a huge change that is happening in this country, right? And lots of local authorities are therefore in charge of certain things, mayors are in charge of certain things, and the direction of travel by this government and all other governments, particularly anything in Scotland, is very clear, all right? And what you're proposing is actually that the national government of the United Kingdom or Great Britain, Northern Ireland, however you want to do it, should actually take power back and then be more in charge of that. With respect, I don't think that's where the direction of travel is. I also genuinely feel there's a key point which I think it must be taken into order, which is if you devolve power, right, the individual person in charge is then responsible. They are also elected. They can have a local manifesto of delivery. on accessibility in a way better way than national governments can. And individual problems can be addressed in an individual way, and things like housing development, all aspects can be addressed locally. And with respect, I think making it work better from the centre is important, but also making sure there is proper local accountability is also important.
Well, with respect, you've slightly reframed my question in many ways, but wasn't a suggestion, it was merely a question as well. But whilst you're talking about dilution and local powers, I may as well ask you this, the question I was going to ask you later on issue with taxes, which you may be aware of. Taxes that are registered in different areas where they are operating at times makes it impossible to enforce things like drivers who refuse to take passengers with guide dogs, etc, etc. So what steps are you going to take or are taking to address it at the moment?
So I saw that bit of evidence and I read it and I noted it and I've asked for a note and I've got a preliminary view, which my preliminary view, and I just want to double check it with lawyers as well, is that an individual local authority can prosecute even when they are not the licensing authority if it takes place outside their local authority. So I know the assertion was made, if I'm registered in X county and an offence takes place in Y county, you can't necessarily bring action. I don't think that is the case. I'm going to double check and I will get back to you and I will write to the committee. But what I do propose is writing as the ministerial lead on this to all local authorities and ramming home the point that this is not acceptable and they need to enforce this. Because if it is not being enforced, I'd like to know and I'd like really much, very much for it to be done.
Okay, thanks so much. Look forward to you getting back to us. If I can turn now to the poacher turned gamekeeper on this inquiry, Minister Merriman. So, in terms of the ORR, who obviously have been brought up a number of times, I suppose if I can quote Stephanie Tobin when she was given the evidence, she said, in terms of fines and improvement notices, as she said, it's not something we'd go into lightly. Certainly in the environment Rail is in now, you have to look at the trade-offs of what impact that would have on the funds of the Secretary of State. Surely it should be the operators that be paying any fines to rather than the government, potentially at the end of the line, if you pardon the pun.
The thing I just want to make absolutely clear, and it's absolute, is that the operators, any station operator, rail operator, has to comply with the accessible transport policy, which is set out and reported on by the regulator. So that is the key part, and cost doesn't come into it. That has to be complied with. That's absolute. So I did see that evidence. I just want to make that absolutely clear. There is no sort of lean-in from anyone from a cost perspective to say, actually, you can't afford to comply. That is not the case at all. Safety and improvements for those who need them is paramount and goes on. And that's why money is invested to ensure that happens. So I just want to be absolutely clear that there's no compromise when it comes to that. And I'm just interested in your question because we obviously have the overarching equalities duty under the Equalities Act, which means that there must be no discrimination from those with protected characteristics, obviously including disabled people. But then when it comes to rail, we do have these specific powers. So we've got the powers of the ORR, and they can intervene as the regulator. We also have contractual powers. So the contracts we have in place with the train operators require them to deliver accessibility performance, and if they don't, then their fee is reduced as well. So that's a financial incentive. We brought the Rail Ombudsman in, and then crucially, we haven't touched on it, and it's always a tragedy when they're involved, but the Rail Accident Investigations Board, it's their work that means that all station platforms will have tactile paving by 2025. So I was almost giving you a case for the status quo there in terms of why I think it's important that each transport sector has its own way of doing things, because the overarching is the Equalities Act, and then we go into the bespoke, which is our own transport sector.
Okay, and with respect to what the position you've given is the position of the government that safety is paramount and cost shouldn't be a factor, but obviously the ORR seem to be saying that cost does come into it when they look at these issues in terms of fines and enforcement notices. Is that something that you'll be addressing, given what you've said in your previous answers, is that something you'll be addressing with the ORR to ensure that this isn't a consideration moving forward?
Yeah, I would expect it to be where, for example, we are investing new monies into, say, step-free access. So the next batch for control period 7 is £350 million. That might be a question of, will it can't be greater than that because we only have a certain amount of money. It should not be when it comes to compliance of existing accessible travel policy. Those have to be complied with. So yes, I will take that up.
Okay, and we've looked at, for instance, aviation, or particularly keen on talking about reputational damage as a key driver for their performance in this area. But would you say, whether it's rail, in fact, whether it's whatever mode of transport, that financial penalties work, or indeed are a necessity to make, or hopefully they're not necessary in the end, but the threat of financial penalties are a necessity to ensure we make progress quickly, or quickly enough in this area?
Yes, and again, with the ORR, the powers they have at the sort of 10% of turnover level, I mean, that's a really draconian power that they can exercise. But again, I think I'm struck, and actually this, in my experience, is the way that the railway community operates, is the ORR, the reason I believe they've not had to issue more enforcement notices, they've been in issue one, as they told you,
yeah,
is because when they take matters up, those matters are then addressed, and there have been a number of matters that have had to be addressed, so therefore doesn't even get to that level, and therefore doesn't get to the fine level.
And lastly, on rail, you said on taking, when the ORR take matters up, Doug Pawley said to us that the ORR are very good when issues are flagged to them and they take those issues up, but they're not proactive enough themselves as an organisation when it comes to looking at accessibility. And is that something you would agree with, or is that something they need to work on?
So I did note that, but also you put that to the ORR, and I think their response was, we have 100 inspectors that go across the railway. That's from a accessibility perspective, and it's also from health and safety. So they look there, they obviously do their surveying as well. They can see where the journeys are, because we can see where the disabled person's rail card has been looked at. But in a way, that's really makes the case for the National Rail Accessibility Strategy and why we need to be a little more uniform across the piece, working with the ORR, so that we can really put something above that, and that's what we intend to do next year.
Okay, and last, I'm conscious of time, if I can on to aviation with Minister Brown. In the your opening remarks, I was pleased to hear your remarks about the CAA and where what powers you would like to see them have, and you spoke about the airport accessibility framework, and also your desire to see that the airlines have a similar framework. So I suppose my question is, how and when are you going to ensure that they see you have the appropriate powers, and also that the airline accessibility framework is put in place?
Yep. For the CAA to get its appropriate powers requires primary legislation, so it's when we have parliamentary time to do it, and I don't know when.
I somehow thought that might be your answer.
Well, unfortunately, it does require primary legislation, so if you can tell me when we have parliamentary time to do it, but I will push for that. There's obviously we've got the parliamentary legislation set up to the election, so it will have to be after the election,
which is when.
You tell me. No idea. For the CAA having an airline accessibility performance framework like it has for airports, my understanding is that they can bring that in. They have the power to bring that in, and they have certainly consulted on it, and we have supported it. But I can write to you precisely on the timing and the mechanism for doing that.
Okay, thanks so much, Chair.
Okay, I just want to ask a quick supplementary on one of the points Gavin made, and that's on the sort of proactiveness of the regulators to intervene with operators. We've touched on ORR, but across the piece, do you think there's a problem that, yes, they will act when issues are brought to their attention, but they need to do more in sort of proactively looking at how operators are performing and take action where necessary?
So in my view, probably yes. I think there is a definite issue as to the mechanism by which information is brought to the regulators in a particular way. It is not for me to create policy on the hoof, but it has struck me very much that there is a information deficit, in the sense that there is lots of occurrences and incidents happening all the time, but trying to bring that together and then into a comprehensible and available piece of information is very difficult. And trying to find a portal by which that is done is difficult. I hesitate to say that Northumberland can lead the way, but there are examples up and down the country with tech where quite simply, and several local authorities would do this, for example, which is if you see a particular pothole, you will then take a photograph of it, upload it to your council's website, and they will respond within 7 days as to how it is that is being done. It's called Fixing the Street. Several local authorities do it. It does strike me that in terms of accessibility in particular, if there was the capacity to upload such information where there was a difficulty or a problem, and then take that to a accessible portal that it can be mapped as well, that is perfectly capable of being done, and local authorities do this up and down the country, and then individual regulators could then be notified and or action on those individual things. Not all case would be genuine, one has to accept that. We would have to have some degree of assessment of that, and without getting into the nuts and bolts. But that would seem to me be an obvious and a simple way of using tech to try and drive forward accessibility of information in this case with actual better outcomes. Now, that's me making up policy on the hoof as I go along here on day 30, but it does strike me that I read the evidence like everybody else, and it is quite clear, it is very difficult for individuals to get in front of regulators all the information they would like to do. That is not acceptable in my view.
Chair, can I just say with regards to the Office of Rail and Road, and Rail, I think it was from Mr. Newland's questioning, they did take the point that because they've only issued one enforcement notice, because they haven't had to go to that level, they could perhaps better publish work that they have done in conjunction with the operator to make improvements and do that better. And I would certainly welcome the committee's recommendations in terms of how we, in the railway sphere, we can be more transparent, provide more information about what's being done, because that gives more confidence to those that have disabilities that they can use the railway and it will work for them. And I think tying that up with the station audit that we're doing, to Ms. Britcliffe's point about getting that published, I want to try and find a way of publishing the data and also find a way of demonstrating that things have been done and action has been taken, so that that's out there in the public domain.
Thank you. Sorry, you wanted to...
Yeah, it's just slightly off topic, but it's just about basic training for staff at stations through the train operating companies. And I say this from a personal experience at Euston last week, which we all know is a very busy station. Yeah. There was three people who were visually impaired. There was no help where they'd booked assistance to get off the train. So I then created a kind of a chain link now. I'm the first to admit I'm quite small, don't have upper body strength. I was also trying to push my suitcase at the same time. But every staff member that I walked up to say, look, these people have required assistance to get off the train, but also then to be taken to the tube station, rather than each staff member saying, don't worry, we will take them to where they need to be, they then passed me on to the next person before I got them actually to the place where they needed to be. So what is the actual basic training that staff have on stations to be able to help people in those positions? Because we know at Euston not everybody is willing to help others as they're getting to where they need to be.
All staff working in the stations, working with customers, are required to have that training to be able to deliver the accessible policy that the operators have to sign up to. So we'll happily take that away and look at that particular matter. I'm sorry to hear of it. But the staff training is provided, it's essential. And again, when we update our policies in terms of the inclusive transport strategy that actually had training as a requirement, we're going to be looking to make sure that all characteristics are taken into account as well as we learn more. So we'll certainly take that away. Liz, I don't know if there's anything you want to talk about.
Can I add in on something that, but which is, we're happy to write to you, which is the answer is quite simply, not just in rail, but in all aspects of transport, there is staff training, all right? The question is, does that sink in? And then that is that implemented? The proof is in the pudding. And it goes back to the fundamental of attitude. And I think one of your witnesses spoke glowingly of the existence of what goes on in Japan, where they have a can-do attitude to such problems, and there isn't a game of pass the parcel, which quite obviously you experienced. And that does happen in this country, and that needs to change.
Thanks, Chair. We've done a survey on this committee that shows that people are
passengers, I guess, are deeply dissatisfied with the complaints processes when operators get something wrong. Do you think that the Department of Transport should consider establishing an ombudsman or a similar system to oversee those complaints in terms of transport accessibility? Because it's really not good enough, is it, if that we've got that many people complaining about the way their complaints have been handled?
Shall I take that first, and then individual ministers can come in, because obviously there is a rail ombudsman already.
Yep. So specifically for access.
I understand that. I understand the point. My personal view is that the case is not made as yet, but that is very early days. What I do believe, though, that there is a transparency, there is a availability of information and then action on that information, we do need a considerable piece of work. And I refer you to the answer I gave to the chair just now. And I think that can be done, because what we're interested in is outcomes rather than a better process, in my humble opinion. And I don't feel that there is the case made for an ombudsman as yet. What I personally would like to do is to run the system better and have better outcomes.
Surely a better process is the key to better outcomes, isn't it, if the process is failing?
I think that basically we have to have a change of attitude, a greater degree of transparency, and we have to have the ability for the individual to record their complaint in whatever shape or form, and then that to be actioned quickly. As we all know, because as MPs we deal with ombudsmen all the time, they are a very slow process, they take many years to action, and it is not necessarily the panacea. It was an invention by the Labour government, which I applaud, and the Health Ombudsman, for example, does good work, but it is only so good as far as it can, is the role it is doing, and it is a slow process. It doesn't get the relatively speedy outcome that we're all seeking, I respectfully say.
On the Rail Ombudsman side, obviously, it's an introduction to 2018, the Rail Ombudsman will take up matters if it supports them, and ultimately, if a resolution can't be found, it can enforce its decision. So we've got the Rail Ombudsman as well as the powers that the rail regulator has to also take action. So I believe that we have got that added strength, and it's certainly the case that the ORR are looking at the sort of five sort of lower performers when it comes to the delivery of the 2-hour. Turn up and go, and I would expect that work to then lead to some improvements.
In the light of what Minister Opperman's just said, and I accept the points that he makes, do you think that the Rail Ombudsman, the current Rail Ombudsman, deals sufficiently well with accessibility complaints, or does the Ombudsman even receive those complaints?
Well, where those complaints are actually made by individuals, then yes, of course, they will then take action. The challenge for me is actually how connected, because we've got various different bodies that can act and take up their powers, because we also have Transport Focus that acts on behalf of passengers as well. It's how interconnected they are. And I think that's something that, again, sort of from this work for this committee, will certainly be in my mind when I ask them if there's more that they can do.
Can I just make a general observation about Ombudsman? That in my previous career in banking, I dealt with the Financial Ombudsman a lot. And know it very well. That there's an advantage to having an ombudsman that's more sort of, and I'm not making any comments about any particular ombudsman apart from the Financial Ombudsman, to having a single ombudsman that's quite powerful and professionalised and got scale and efficiency. So in financial services, instead of having a banking ombudsman, an insurance ombudsman and so on and so forth, you have one Financial Ombudsman. And the advantages are, from the public's point of view, it's got visibility. They know it. Whereas if you have lots of little ombudsmen with different responsibilities, they don't know. If you've got lots of little ombudsmen, they don't professionalise in the same way. They don't get the same quality of staff. There is a definite read across of skills being an ombudsman in one sub-sector to a related sector, and bring them together under one roof in financial services was definitely had beneficial impacts from a consumer's point of view. In the in aviation, so my specific ministerial responsibility, I mentioned that at the moment, obviously, there is no ombudsman. There are disputes, alternative dispute resolution mechanisms, and the membership of that is voluntary and by airlines and airports, and we want to make that mandatory.
Thank you. Very helpful. Yeah. Thanks, Chair.
Thank you. And Just an observation on the back of that. One of the common thread through the issues that have been raised with us by passengers is that it's such a complex area for them to try and get redress when there's problems. In the rail system, there is actually a very good scheme when delays happen, delay repay.
Yeah.
And the passenger knows where to go, and they don't have to worry about, well, this was a network rail problem or a train operating problem. That's all sorted out behind the scheme. So just I don't want to prejudge what our recommendations will be, but a scheme like that, that is very visible and accessible to passengers, that they can go to when there's a problem, and then the system kicks in. So I'll leave that with you. We're coming to the end of the session. You'll be relieved to hear. I've just got a couple of final specific questions I'd like to ask. Firstly, with regards to buses and coaches, many are exempt from the public service vehicle accessibility regulations, and that they're unlikely to meet the required standard when the exemptions expire in 2026. What's going to happen then? Will there be support available to operators to upgrade their vehicles?
Well, I've done select committees for 8 years and said I've never actually been able to announce stuff at a select committee. But I'm pleased to say...
That's your moment.
That in day one of my select committee career in transport, I'm pleased to say that there will be £4.6 million in grant funding for smaller operators to mitigate the cost of complying with the Public Service Vehicle Accessible Information Regulations 2023. There is a process which I'm going to write to the committee on, which will start in January 2024 to address some of those problems. And the department would clearly like me to make the point that I think 99% are compliant, but clearly we need more to do on the smaller operators.
That is excellent news. We look forward to
here is the piece of paper
to having seeing the
said.
Detail. Thank you for that. And finally, just want to touch on how the needs of people with disabilities are factored into the design of streetscapes. It's often seems to be done as an afterthought, rather than being I think this comes into the your attitude point, that it's there in the process anyway. What measures do you envisage putting in place to help with that?
I massively want to lean into a whole host of particular organisation, but particularly housing and the way that new estates are designed. I think it makes total sense to do that, both from an active travel point of view, but from an accessibility point of view. I note the point on what's called floating bus stops, which are a problem. I have very strong personal views, which I probably shouldn't express as robustly as some have done, about e-scooters, which someone described as e-litter. I find it astonishing that we allow in 2023 obstructions to be going on the street in the way we're doing. We clearly, if I was to stay in post and we were to be able to do this, need to have a legislation whereby these are docked in the usual way. It seems to me utterly unacceptable that we are creating obstructions on an ongoing basis. I get that there's a trial. The department are very keen for me to make that point, that it's a trial and individual local authorities are looking at this. My personal view is there needs to be a docking system ASAP.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much. That concludes our questioning this morning. Can I thank all of you very much indeed for your times. I think it's been a very informative session, and we hope to bring forward our recommendations and conclusions in good time, and that you'll be able to take up what we recommend. But for now, again, thank you very much for your time this morning. Order, order.